please open up to Luke chapter 6. We're going to be looking at verses 12 to 19 this morning. Luke chapter 6, verses 12 to 19. So hear God's word. In those days, he went out to the mountain to pray. And all night he continued in prayer to God. And when day came, he called his disciples and chose from them 12, whom he named apostles. Simon, whom he named Peter, and Andrew, his brother, and James, and John, and Philip, and Bartholomew, and Matthew, and Thomas, and James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon, who was called the Zealot, and Judas, the son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who became a traitor. And he came down with them and stood on a level place with a great crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from all Judea and Jerusalem and the seacoast of Tyre and Sidon, who came to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. And those who were troubled with unclean spirits were cured, and the crowd sought to touch him, for the power came out from him and healed them all. This is God's word.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for welcoming us. Any nice friends? it's great. It's great to be here with you this morning. You're welcome here. It's been great. My wife and my mom and my sister are in the back. I grew up in Queens, and so I know what suffering is like. But let's get to the sermon. So I've been having problems this week with my phone. Right, the apps. The screen freezes and the apps don't work. And my sister the other day saw me like struggling with it, right? Like frustrated trying to text. And she was like, why don't you just turn it off and turn it on again? Like, you know, I did that and lo and behold, it works. So turning it on and turning it off refreshes the apps and the internal workings of the phone and they let the apps start to work again. And something like this is happening in the text this morning. We're gonna see that God in this passage is doing something. He's restarting something that he had started in the Old Testament. It didn't work, and now he's restarting it again. So this passage breaks down into three nice sections, so we'll consider those sections in order to understand what it is that he's doing and why should we care, how does it affect us. Okay, so the verse 12 and 13, we'll call the restart. 14 to 16, the new kind of community, and 17 to 19, the source of the power. Okay, so the restart, the new kind of community, and the source of the power. So let's reread again, verse 12 to 13. It says, in these days he went out to the mountains to pray, and all night he continued in prayer to God. And when day came, he called his disciples and chose from them 12, whom he named apostles. So imagine this, you're in the basketball court, you go to the basketball court, and all the kids of the neighborhood are there playing basketball, and they stink. So like you're there, you know, ready with their, you know, with your shorts, with your jersey, and with your sneakers, Jordans of course. And you go to the bleacher and you start to pick five. Everybody in the basketball court knows what you're doing. You're picking a team. You don't have to say it, you're picking a team. If basketball is not your sport, if that's not your thing, okay, imagine soccer, right? You're in the soccer field, everybody's playing soccer, and you go to the stands and you pick 11 people. Everybody knows what you're doing. You're making a team. You're getting ready to play. So this is what's happening here. The same thing. Jesus goes up to the mountain to meet with God. He comes down to his disciples, 12 of them. He picks 12 of them and then gives them the law of God, which is the next section in this chapter, the Sermon on the Mount. So question, who else in the Bible went up to the mountain to meet with God, came down to the people of God, represented by 12, and gave them the law of God? Who else did that? Moses, of course, right? The answer is Moses. So that's what, you know, this is screaming to us. That there's a link there. There's a link with Jesus in this passage and Moses in that story. So in order to understand what Jesus is doing, we need to go back to the story of Moses in Exodus and see what it was that God was doing with the people of God at that time. So very briefly, let's do this in a couple minutes. So we pick up the story, right, from the beginning. So a small batch of Hebrews goes from Canaan to Egypt because they were hungry, right? And Egypt had food. Remember the story of Joseph. And there were only 12 families, you know, very, very few people, 70 people. And these 12 families grew over time to become tribes of their own, huge. And then over time, the Egyptians became very feeling threatened by them. And so they made them slaves. They put them into forced slavery because they felt threatened by their growth. In that moment of slavery and of pain, they started crying out to God. And God heard their cry, right? And God sent a deliverer. He remembered his covenant with Abraham, and he sent a deliverer, which was Moses. And we know the story, right? Moses confronts the Pharaoh, and after an amazing story, Moses delivers the people of Israel out of slavery into freedom in the desert. And there in the desert, a free people, free, God gives them, calls Moses up to a mountain and gives them the law, his law. And so Moses comes down the mountain and he gives the law of God to the people of God. And they are, from that moment on, no longer just tribes in the desert. No longer just tribes. From that moment on, with the law of God, they become a bona fide nation. They're a nation, a special people, a special community. In this special community, God had a mission for them. It wasn't just, okay, you're just a nation, that's great, you know, like, have fun. But they had a purpose. And the purpose of the nation of Israel, we can read in Isaiah, I'll read it briefly, Isaiah 49:6, is for them to be a light to the Gentiles, that God's salvation may reach the ends of the earth. That was the purpose of the nation of Israel. And that was the purpose that God had saved them, so that through Israel, they would be the vehicle, the channel through which God's grace would flow to all the nations of the world. That was the mission. But they failed. Instead of being that channel, Israel became self-centered, self-important, and even racist. And we see the in the book of Jonah, we see a little glimpse of the attitude that Israel had developed towards other nations. You know, like, you know the story of Jonah. He was he was more than hesitant, right? He didn't want to go to preach the gospel to Nineveh. And so that was the case with Israel. They became very isolated and insulated. And so God's project with Israel did not work because of Israel's hardness of heart. It was frozen, like my abs, right? And here we go back to our passage in the verse 12 to 14, and we see Jesus restarting the project of God. Okay, so, but now does the mission change? The mission doesn't change. Actually, the mission of this new community represented by these 12 people is the same: to bring the gospel, to bring the grace of God to the nations. But instead of being the channel through which salvation would flow to the nations, now God sends them into the nations. So there's that distinction. But the mission remains, it's renewed. Okay, so let's look at this new community that Jesus restarts, right? Let's look at this community in point number two. And we have it here. It's just a list of the apostles, right? Simon, whom he named Peter, and Andrew, his brother, and James, and John, and Philip, and Bartholomew, and Matthew, and Thomas, and James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon, whom he called the Zealot, and Judas, the son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who became the traitor. What do you see in this list? Anything striking? Anything jump out at you? There are many things, as I was preparing, there are many things that were like, wow, it's just a list. And then all of a sudden, like, I started seeing all these things. But let's just focus on two things. There's unexpected things. So You know, Jesus calls, Jesus being a rabbi, he calls 12 people to himself. And there are a couple of them that are like, really? Why would you pick them? Like, for example, Thomas, a cynic, a doubter. Isn't it a requirement of a disciple of a religious person, a religious teacher, to be a person of deep faith and conviction? Isn't that like a requirement? And yet Jesus chooses Thomas to be one of the 12. A doubter, a cynic, you know? And so what does that tell us? It tells us that God, that Jesus is really patient with our doubts. That he's patient with those that doubt, right? Like, if you may be here today, and like, you know, you struggle with some of the things. You struggle with some of the things that Jesus or that we see in the Bible. And God is patient. And so continue. He welcomes the questions. He welcomes the struggle. And he welcomed Thomas into the circle, right? We see Matthew here. Incredible. A tax collector. A white-collar thief. a traitor of his nation. Like, it's crazy that God, that Jesus would include him in the circle, because he was a man with a really bad reputation. I mean, tax collectors were seen as the worst, right? Traitor, thief. And yet Jesus includes him. And I don't know, like, where you're coming from. I don't know what kind of reputation you may have. Maybe you're here, you have, you know, like, people say bad things about you outside. And maybe your family has blackballed you or put you on the blacklist, or maybe your friends have. But Jesus doesn't care about your reputation outside. He welcomes you. He welcomed Matthew. So we see that. Simon the Zealot, right? I mean, he's a dogmatic, hyper-political type, right? Everything was politics for him. Like, Jesus includes in his circle even those that have misguided politics, whether on the right or the left, right? That's some interesting things, unexpected candidates to be part of the circle of Jesus, right? Okay, here, let's continue. Here's another thing that I found striking. I'm sure that there's tons more. But what I found striking in this list is the incredible diversity that we see. And it's indicative of the people of God, of this new community that God is creating. So, for example, let's look at this. There are rich and poor. They are educated and uneducated, introverts and extroverts, emotional types and intellectual types, blue collar and white collar, conservative and liberal, to the known and the obscure. There are brothers, there are friends, and there are natural enemies. Jesus brings all these people together, not merely tolerating each other. They weren't called to just tolerate, but they were there to love each other. Think about, like, let's think about a little bit, like, what must their meetings must be like? Like, for example, Matthew and Simon the Zealot, right? Matthew the traitor of his nation and Simon the Zealot, the really hyper political type. Did they ever talk about politics? Can you imagine that conversation? Like, oh my goodness, right? How about Peter's table talk with Thomas? Peter, the hyper, you know, like, oh, I believe everything, right? Like, just call me on the water. And Thomas, the doubter, intellectual type. Peter being rough around the edges, like, you know, like, very rough. And Thomas was maybe, like, very refined. Like, can you imagine their conversations? I wonder if they got under each other's skin. Like, oh, there he goes again, Peter. Or like, oh, Thomas. You know what I mean? Like, I wonder how they did life together. What kept them together? You know, like, we can be in a venue, like, for a little while. I mean, we can, you know, like, you know, Boston Red Sox fans. Like, I can be with them for a little bit, right? But how long can you be with them, really? Right? But here we see that they, even though they were different, like, they stuck together for 3 years and then afterwards, not just tolerating, but loving each other. What was it that kept them there? So interesting. And of course we know the answer. The answer, it was grace. It was because of Jesus. Christian community is not just a group of people that have an affinity or similar interest. It's a new humanity, a new kind of community, one called to be one, one called to love each other. John 13, 34 to 35 says, Love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. The call is to love, not tolerate. It's deeper. They loved each other because they had experienced the searing grace of God. As important as politics and economics and race are, they became secondary to Jesus. Jesus was their most important common denominator. Everything else is secondary. This doesn't mean that community is not messy though, right? Heather Zembel, in her book, Community is Messy, she writes, community is great until you actually experience it. Community is messy. Messy community is not the exception to the rule. It is the rule. So, you know, then you know it begs the question, why is it so messy? Well, because we're different. And we all come broken. So because we are different, and because we all come broken, it's gonna be messy. Sample continues, the good news is that that mess, when engaged rightly, can be the very thing that brings what we want most, community and growth. I mean, imagine if you just stuck to the people that think like you, look like you, do things like you. It's like eating food with only salt and salt and salt, just salty foods, right? But just imagine the richness that you're missing out. You're missing out on the sweets, on the bitter, on the tangy, on the, you know, like all these other flavors if you just stick to one kind. And in the body of Christ, as we see here, it's very diverse for a reason. In it, we find true community and growth. And that is why we engage it. That is why you want it. In Christian community, there are resources to love each other in our differences. Not superficially, but deeply. So it gives us two resources, right? The fact that you have been saved by grace gives you a humble disposition to your brother. You know that it is by sheer grace that you have been saved. You know that it is just because of Jesus that you have been brought in, period. And so you know that you're not morally better than the other person. And so you can come and learn and be patient with the other person, because Jesus has been patient with you, and so you can be patient with others. You can be patient because God was patient with you. He was patient with the difficult, with the different, and the unlovable. And so the same God, he was patient with us, the difficult, the different, and he made us lovable. So being saved also, okay, so being saved by grace, gives us a humble attitude towards our brother and sister. But it also affirms us. This is really beautiful. God loved you, and he made you with your special traits and gifts and talents, and he gave them to you for the benefit of us all. And so you're not only tolerated, you're loved and you're needed. We need you. So here are some practical tips, you know, to help grow in this community, in this engagement of community. I'll give you seven really quickly, okay? If anybody was taking notes. So number one, just get connected. Somehow get connected. Don't wait for the community to come to you. You go and get connected. Seek it out. Number two, once in it, affirm each other's gifts. When you notice somebody who's serving in a certain way, that they do it really well, tell them about it, encourage them. Or maybe you see your brother or your sister growing in their faith, maybe with self-control, growing in their joy. Like, go tell them, like, you know what, I've seen you are so joyful lately. Like, it just makes me so happy. Just encourage each other, right? Romans 12:10 says, honor one another above yourselves. Okay, that was number two. Number three, affirm one another's equal importance in Christ. So in the world, class, how much money you have, where you come from, what school you went to, what race you are, those are all really important things, right? In In the church, in this new community, those distinctions are secondary. We are all equal in God's sight. So build relationships with those that are different. And I mean, we live in Queens, right? That shouldn't be, that, like, you don't have to go out of your way to find somebody that's different. We live in the most diverse place, plot of land in the whole planet Earth. So let's do that, right? God has given that to us here. Number four, show affection. Oh man, I was gonna say, I'm Latino. Like, Latinos don't have a problem with that, right? Like, we're very touchy people. But like, maybe it's difficult for you, but try to show it. You know, Ephesians 4:32, it says, be kind and compassionate to one another. In another place it says, it says, greet one another with a kiss. Like, what does that mean? How do we translate that to our culture, right? So gotta do that with care. Okay, so don't be cold or harsh or indifferent to one another. Show affection. Don't be afraid to show your emotions to each other. Share your needs and problems. Galatians 6:22 says, carry each other's burdens, right? Number six, two more. You're like, I can imagine my niece going like, oh, seven. Okay, six. This is number six. Share beliefs, thinking, and spirituality. Colossians 3:16 says, teach and admonish each other. So how can you teach without sharing your thoughts, right? So share your thoughts with each other. And your spirituality, don't keep it to yourself. You know, it says in Ephesians 5:19, speak to one another with songs, hymns, and spiritual songs. So share each other, your growth in God, your experiences with Jesus. Okay, number seven, last one. Share your space, goods, and time. 1 Peter 4:9 says, offer hospitality to one another. Romans 12:10 says, be devoted to one another. So visit each other. Hang out with one another. So because we experience God's grace in Jesus, we can do this, right? Remember what Ephesians 4:32 says, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ forgave you. Forgiving each other. He's kind of expecting us to get in each other's nerves, right? Oh, there goes Erica. Or something like that. But forgiving each other. Just like Christ forgave you. Okay? You see, secularism and other religions cannot produce this kind of loving community. In the modern secular society, there is no incentive for sacrificial covenantal love like this. The working foundation in our modern society is, what's in it for me? Or, if you think like me, then I'm gonna hang with you. If you think like them, then I don't want anything to do with you. That's the attitude of our politics, or our economics, and even between our races, right? And so, whether you would describe yourself as a Christian today or not, this new kind of community is something you want. You want this in your society. You want this in your neighborhood. You want this in your city. I mean, even the fact that Judas Iscariot is in that list is shocking, right? It's amazing that he's there. I mean, did Jesus not know that he was going to betray him? Of course he did. But the gospel gives us the resources to love not only those that believe as we do, but also those that don't believe as we do. He even gave him a chance to be part of the circle. And then he calls him a friend. So this is the kind of community that Jesus creates. One that would look at his at one that is going to betray him and call him a friend. Isn't that what motivated Martin Luther King Jr., right? I mean, he was a Christian man. And to those that persecuted him, he called them his brothers. In his I Have a Dream speech, he famously said that he longed to sit with those who opposed him at the table of hope, brotherhood. That's powerful. And that's what we have in this community that Jesus creates. But let's take a deeper look into the power of the community, right? In our point number three, the source of power. Let's go to verse 17 to 19, and I read, and he came down with them and stood on a level place, and a great crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from from all Judea, Jerusalem, and the seacoast of Tyre and Sidon, who came to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. And those who were troubled with unclean spirits were cured. And all the crowd sought to touch him, for power came out from him and healed them all. So here we see the power of Jesus in two forms. There's probably much more, but I identify two: the power of attraction and the power to bring wholeness. So let's just briefly look at these two. The power of to bring wholeness. You know, Jesus in this passage we see, he's not just a teacher. There is something different about him. He's not just a regular rabbi. There is power that emanates out of him. And he heals people. He heals the sick. And he heals the soul of those who are emotionally and spiritually oppressed. He was approachable, and he let the crowds touch him. He wasn't like a rock star with an entourage of bodyguards, you know? He was accessible, and he still is. So, come to him. If you're experiencing problems in your relationships, health problems, emotional pain, maybe you're here and your heart is broken for whatever reason. Come to Jesus this morning. He heals. And also I see the power of his power of attraction. There's tons of people flocking to him, right? You know what? There's something beautiful about Jesus, about his teaching, about his life, and who he is. He comes down, and there are great crowds of disciples and a great multitude of people, including Jews and Gentiles. And they sought to touch him because they knew that they would be healed by him. Jesus doesn't have the power like a bomb has a power. A bomb has the power to disperse and destroy. Jesus has the power to bring in and heal. Jesus has the power that attracts. And isn't that the case in history? Person after person that starts to examine Jesus, they start reading the Bible, and they start seeing who he is, the beauty of his character, the grace of his words and actions, the glory of what he did. They're attracted to him. Like, for example, Gandhi, right? He wasn't a Christian. You know, he famously said, I like your Christ, but I don't like your Christians. Okay, fair enough. But he couldn't deny that attraction that Jesus had. I mean, why is that? Well, it's because of the way he lived and the way he died. Let's look at the way he lived. You know, Jesus loved those people who were where they were. He loved them where they were. And constantly sought them out to bring them in. Even if they were different than he was. For example, the Samaritan woman in John 4, he crossed a gender, cultural, and national difference to help her. With lepers, he crossed cultural and religious taboos. You know, a rabbi wasn't supposed to touch lepers. But he went and touched them, healed them. With sinners and tax collectors, you know, those on the fringes of society, he showed them mercy and included them. He hung out with them. He restored them. With the rich, he was not interested in their influence, but he loved them for who they were. I'm thinking of Zacchaeus, Matthew, Nicodemus, you know, people with money. He wasn't interested in their influence, what they could do for him. He loved them for who they were. With the powerful and connected, he was not afraid of them. Spoke truth to power. With the Gentiles, he brought them in and made them part of the people of God. That's how he lived. Do you see that? Do you see yourself in that list? Has he crossed barriers to get to you? So let's look at how he died. Finally, how he died is powerful, and it is the most beautiful thing that attracts us to him. He died rejected by his own people so that we could be drawn into the people of God. He died outside of the city so that we could be brought into the city of God. He died alone so that we would never be. He died mocked that we may be affirmed. He died naked that we may be clothed in his righteousness. And this is the key of the power of this new community. This is the key of Jesus' power, the secret of this new kind of humanity. The key is that Jesus lived and died for his new community. His life and death brings us to him and keeps us there, committed to him and to one another. And he sends us out together into a world in need so that they too may find healing in him. Do you see him living for you and dying for you today? If you do, then see that he has made you part of this new community. We call it the church. Engage it. You need it and you are needed. Come, be part of the healing. Be part of this new community that Jesus is making. Be part of this new restart that we saw in the first verses. Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you for never quitting on your